Hey there, it's Rachel Mullins, the host of Hashtag No Filter Fridays on Public House Media.
Throughout history, the course of sports has been shaped by one thing, the fans.
From the moments you never dreamed of.
The moments that still give you nightmares.
Behind the back, it gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight, and the Mets win it. He's in! Patriots win the Super Bowl! Brady has his fifth!
Through the good and the bad, fans have helped change the games we watch and the players we love.
They may not be the most logical people.
You are a factory of sadness!
I'll see you Sunday.
But they know their teams better than anybody.
They'll blow in the ninth.
You may not always see them, but you know where to find them.
After all, there's nothing quite like the view from the cheap seats.
Broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network.
Grab a chair and enjoy all there is in
the cheap seats. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, of all ages, welcome back once again up into the cheap seats, brought to you by Public House Media. As always on a Tuesday, I'm Josh Powers, joined by John Lauder. John, say hello to the people out there.
Hello, people.
All right, John. So here we are, just at the very start of March. We're starting to kind of come up on the last remaining vestiges of college basketball regular seasons, and I know that you have some big news, right?
Do I?
Do you?
I don't believe so.
What did Hofstra do? Did Hofstra do something special?
Oh. yeah, they won the CAA regular season championship for the second year in a row.
Right.
But they are have not made the NCAA tournament in, I want to say, 20-something years now. I think it was 92 or 93, if I'm not mistaken. So... they've done a lot of great work in the regular season the last few years, but just have not been able to get over the hump. They've gotten to the CAA tournament final a couple of years, and anybody that knows college basketball knows that the Colonial is a one-bid league. You got to win the tournament, yeah. Unless you go like 30-0, which doesn't really happen. So they need to win the whole thing. The tournament is this weekend in D.C., so hopefully they will get it done, and I will finally get to see the alma mater go to the NCAA tournament. But yes, great season again. Joe Mihalik, the former Niagara coach, has done some really good work at Hofstra, but they need to finish the deal and get into the tournament. So hopefully that will happen.
Yeah, so good luck to Hofstra as Appreciate it. Their conference tournament. And yeah, let's go. Let's go. Yeah, speaking of going, I suppose that Tony Romo is going to be going to the bank with a pretty big smile on his face.
Oh, yeah.
After getting that contract from CBS, $17 million for an announcer to call, one game a week, I guess, right? Or maybe two when it comes to playoff season or playoff, you know, the postseason. So that's pretty crazy. You know what I should have done, and I didn't get around to it? I should have looked up Tony Romo's career earnings as a quarterback, because he's making quarterback money as an announcer now. And Twitter's reaction over the weekend when that was announced was pretty remarkable, especially from players who are still currently in the league.
Yeah, honestly, Josh, it's embarrassing. It doesn't make any sense. And look, I mean, if you can get the money, get it. I'm not suggesting he shouldn't.
Absolutely.
And obviously, what he's done in just a couple of years is incredible. I mean, he's already arguably the best football color commentator in the sport, which is, you know, incredible.
It's saying something, especially because the really successful Dallas Cowboys quarterback, who's also a color commentator, seems to, I don't know if you'd say Troy Aikman's lost a step or so, but I think he's pretty darn good. I can't stand his partner. I can't stand Joe Buck as a play-by-play man. But it seems like Cowboys QBs have a tendency to know a little bit about what they're watching.
For sure. And as we're talking about this, I've realized we have to do a show on broadcasters at some point. That's on the list. But I mean, look, Romo's done an incredible job, but the contract is worth over $100 million. I'm not exactly sure how many years it is. I don't even think that's been announced yet. But he only made $17 million a year or more 3 years, three times as a quarterback. And now he's going to do it for at least 6 or 7 years because the contract has been reported to be over $100 million. So
right.
Quick math, 17 times 6 is 102. So it's at least 6 years.
Yep.
And it's crazy. He's doing 20 games next year, Josh. So he will make just a shade under $1 million a game, which is crazy. I mean, the highest amount prior to this was John Madden and John Gruden, who both made $8 million a year. Now, the last time Madden did this, obviously, was a while ago. So for inflation,
yeah.
I saw online it would be about $14 million. But even still, it's insane. And players have a right to be pissed. Michael Thomas commented on it. A lot of other guys did. I mean, look, again, get your money. But it's crazy to me that a guy calling games is going to make $17 million, and then there are guys in the league starting who are going to make, you know, less than two.
Right.
It just doesn't really make a lot of sense.
Yeah, it is a crazy thing, especially considering what CBS had to, I guess, had to lose when it comes down to it, right? Because there were rumors coming out, certainly, that ESPN was going to make a run at Romo. And I would have much rather seen Romo in the Monday Night Football booth with whoever calls play-by-play, because that booth is terrible right now. Mm-hmm. And yeah, let's make it a habit, I guess, on one of these episodes coming up to break down your we're going to talk about brackets pretty shortly here, your announcer brackets. Let's see that. So a little bit of a tease for the listeners out there.
Yeah, we're going to have several bracket shows for sure.
Absolutely. John, do you actually, now it's undisputed that Romo's great. He came out his rookie year and was able to just sort of predict the plays. It's almost like he had his own personal spygate up in the booth there, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you actually care, I guess, about who calls the games that you're watching? I mean, where did the announcers fall in your hierarchy of what games you're going to watch over the weekend that are not necessarily your team's games?
Yeah, it's interesting because obviously I think we're both biased as people that are in the media. I've done play-by-play and color analysis before. I've been doing it since I was 18 years old. So, you know, certainly not on an NFL on CBS level. But
sure.
So I do care about the announcers, but only to a certain extent. You know, obviously, if the Packers are on, I'm watching, even though I'm not the biggest Buck and Aikman fan. You know, I won't necessarily choose what NFL games are, you know, what NFL games I'm going to watch based on the announcers. I will tell you one thing, though. When I'm watching the NCAA tournament, I will pick games based on who's calling them, especially in those first couple of weekends where there's a million games to choose from.
Sure.
And I don't have seven televisions. I am going to pick if Ian Eagle's doing the game, if well, when Gus Johnson used to do it, because I just found him so amusing.
Yeah,
I'm a
probably
big fan
the most
also.
Amusing announcer
yeah,
out there.
I'm also a big fan of Spiro Dedis, who does games for CBS. So for something like the tournament, definitely. For football, I'm watching it if it's a game I care about, regardless of who's calling the game. Now, there are people who say that, you know, the announcers make no difference at all and it doesn't matter. And that's garbage. I mean, that's not true. You know, if you watch the game with the sound off, it gets pretty boring very quickly. So it is important. Is it $17 million a year important? No. But you're right. ESPN was going to make a bid. CBS obviously wanted to keep Romo because, again, and this is something we could certainly talk about in another show, sports content is the most important thing going right now because it's the ultimate reality show and it can't be DVR'd because you need to watch it live because we all have these things called cell phones. And it's almost impossible not to get the score. So that's why these TV networks are paying ridiculous amounts of money to keep this stuff. And they want their talent staying with their network.
Yeah, no question about that. And it's crazy because I seem to remember this past NFL season that Dan Fouts and, gosh, who's his partner? I think it is Ian Eagle. Yeah, the bird and the beard. They seem to be doing pretty much, I think it was something like 70% of Steelers games. And it really annoyed me because I find Dan Fouts' voice a little bit irritating. He's okay. I mean, he definitely knows his stuff, but I feel like he almost kind of phones it in from time to time. And that's too bad because obviously I respect him as a player. And
of course,
you know, there's that aspect of it for sure, but it just kind of started to irritate me a little bit. And then each of us is going to have our preference as far as like the local announcers as well. And just to shill Pittsburgh again, you know, we have on the hockey side of things, Mike Lang is a Hall of Famer when it comes to hockey play-by-play. He has these catchphrases, and I think every announcer has certain styles that really get them over with the hometown team. And if you ever get a chance, look up Mike Lang goal calls, just somewhere randomly on the internet. It's hilarious, and you're going to find yourself just screaming it at your kids from time to time. It's unbelievable. Mike Lang goal calls. Definitely take a look at that. I used to have a Mike Lang goal call sounder on my phone, and it was, just tremendous work by the Hall of Famer there. So speaking of people who really want to keep their jobs, it's come to that time of, I guess, not really the time of the year, but that time of the decade or every periodic time when contract negotiations come up, not just for announcers, but for NFL players as well. The collective bargaining agreement is set to expire next year, I believe. And we have a proposal from the owners that really kind of shakes things up a great deal. Players would get a little bit of a pay bump at the expense of playing a 17th game. Now, I believe that also includes cutting one preseason game, three preseason games as opposed to four.
Correct.
And then a 17th regular season game. And in addition to that, we're going to see two additional teams, one per conference, added to the playoffs, which means that only one first round bye would be handed out as opposed to two. There's been some amendments, and there's been some talk back and forth. Some veteran players who've made a whole bunch of money over the course of their careers hate the deal, but the average rank and file player who makes, say, an average of $4 million a year, they're all in. They dig it. So, John, what are your thoughts just upon hearing some of the details of the new CBA? Do you like a 17-game regular season schedule? Or do you think, like me, that it's just a logistical travesty?
Yeah, I am not about it at all. The only benefit that I see is that it would push the Super Bowl back to President's Day, which is something that should have been done years and years and years ago, because the day after the Super Bowl should be a national holiday. So that part I like. Other than that, I don't like the deal at all. Less preseason games is great, but honestly, I could care less if there was two preseason games. 7-0. I don't care. I don't watch them anyway, so it doesn't matter to me. I think 16 is perfect. I don't like the new playoff format either, because I think the two byes are important. I think the two best teams should be rewarded, not just the best one in each conference. And also, the 17th game, players would be capped on how much money they would make, and it wouldn't be based on your contract for the other 16, which is absurd. It makes absolutely no sense at all. So I don't think the deal is particularly great for the players. Yes, they get a slight bump, and apparently they wouldn't do marijuana testing anymore, which obviously the players want, and there'd be less contact in the preseason and all that. But I actually think the less contact thing is a negative, because how terrible are the first couple of games of the season typically, because they're not doing enough in the preseason in practice, because the preseason games are garbage. They don't mean anything. It's right. The practice and, you know, installing new stuff in the preseason that matters, especially for these new coaches that are, you know, working with new quarterbacks, or if the quarterbacks have a new offensive coordinator, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I personally don't think the deal is great. And the other thing is, it's for 10 years, which to me is absurd. Why you wouldn't visit it sooner? Have they always been 10 years? That's not something I really know. Probably should have looked that up. But yeah, to me, the deal's not great. But again, I'm also not the one out there throwing, catching, tackling. So it's not really up to me. But for me personally, I don't love it.
Yeah, I think I don't think 10 years is actually that big of a stretch. I think just as you and I get older, 10 years seems like a shorter period of time than it did.
Right.
But yeah, that would have placed the last one at 2011. So,
oh, yeah, that does make sense. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, that sure doesn't seem like that long ago, but no. that's about right. So, I agree with you. And I didn't actually even think of it in the way that you mentioned with the preseason games. In fact, I think that this, if we do have three preseason games, what is the single goal of, say, an average starter in the preseason? Don't get hurt.
Right, exactly.
Don't get hurt. So if you have, I would almost like to see them lengthen training camps and adjust some of the rules for practices along those lines as well. And we haven't, you and I are not privy to the actual documents. There have been some other players that say that, 85% of the players in the league don't know what's in the CBA anyway. And that's probably why they get caught with drugs in an unreasonable period of time as well. But I definitely think that the relaxation of the marijuana testing is a good thing. There's no question about that, especially just as more and more states move to legalize that across all applications, I suppose. So we'll see where that goes. So I think that the league getting ahead of things as far as that aspect is a positive. 17 games just is completely nonsensical to me.
Because
and like I mentioned before, it's because of the logistics. You've got almost a perfect format with the 16 games. You would have to decide, you know, who alternates the 9 home games versus 8 home games. There's a lot more money to be worked out when it comes to those things. And I've heard say that, the NFC would have 9 home games 1 year. The AFC would have 9 home games the next year. And, I mean, there's definitely some compromises that can be made. But really what you're doing is you're just shifting a preseason game into a regular season. How would you set up whom you play as well? There are some scenarios where just kind of a natural rival ends up working itself out. So for example, maybe if the NFL wants to continue to expand into new markets and do neutral site games, like there's going to be a game in Mexico City that Arizona is going to host this year. Obviously the London experiment seems to be pretty lucrative. It's still nonsensical to me. I mean, you might as well move the Jacksonville Jaguars to London, England at this point, because they're playing 3 or 4 games over there anyway. But maybe they experiment with that 17th game being a neutral site game for like a natural, maybe interconference rival, right? For example, in the preseason, almost every year, the Pittsburgh Steelers play the Philadelphia Eagles, right? They're not really rivals at all, other than being on opposite ends of the same state. But what if you play that game at Beaver Stadium, where there's 100,000 seats and it's halfway between the two?
Be huge.
It'd be enormous. And there's a lot of fan bases that would certainly welcome that. But what that might do is weaken your division rivalries that are already established, and the NFL is aligned in a certain way that doesn't make a whole lot of sense in some aspects based on those vintage division rivalries too. So I don't know. There's a lot that really can go into it, and I think we're still at the early stages. But by all accounts, the players seem to be ready to ratify it. So I guess we'll see where it goes. But to me. And obviously I've never put on those pads at that level. If I am making less money for one more game, I'm going to have to get a whole lot more back than just an extra percentage of the overall take.
Absolutely.
So that's kind of where we come down on that. And then lastly, John, in addition to the CBA coming up, in addition to big money for announcers, we've got another aspect of the NFL that we always look forward to, I guess, that none of us really actually knows anything about, and that's the scouting combine. Did you watch any of the scouting combine drills, or is that something that you find yourself into, or is it for you, like me, really easy to ignore it?
I literally did not watch a second. And I have in the past. It's not even that I don't like it necessarily. I just haven't even really had I just didn't have a chance to watch. But I do find it interesting. What I typically do rather than watch is read up afterwards some of the draft people that I really like, just seeing what they think and interesting stuff and who the Packers might take and stuff like that. I really hope they get Henry Ruggs, but he's probably going to go too high at this point. Because I do believe he's going to be the next Tyreek Hill. He would be my pick.
Yeah, that's a need for them for sure.
Yeah, yeah. But no, I did not get a chance to watch the scouting combine.
Yeah, I pretty much just catch up on the highlights of some of those big name players that I've heard either out of college or end up just doing crazy things. Like DK Metcalf was a name that came out of the combine last year, and he had a pretty nice season for Seattle, all things said and done. And I was looking for that guy's progress as his career would develop in his rookie season, and he proved the scouts pretty much correct. And there's always some that are kind of busts and kind of boomers as well, but you know what? You're not gonna. We say it all the time, right? You can't really tell what a player is going to be when he's running around in shorts and a dry fit t-shirt. You just can't tell just yet. But you know what? We flock to it anyway because, yeah, I mean, we all want to see our team take the best talent available.
Yeah, absolutely. 100%.
So our poll question for the fans out there, there's a lot of off-season NFL action going on, whether it's the scouting combine, is that just too much exposure to dudes you know nothing about, or can you just never get enough? Is $17 million enough for the best play-by-play? Well, I'm sorry, the best color man in the game, or is that just too much? Is the NFL giving up way too little or way too much with its new collective bargaining agreement? That's the question out for you guys. Off-season football, too little, too much. How much is too much? How much is too much? That's our what we're gonna go with for our theme today. John, what did you learn?
I think I learned that the players really need to be careful about this negotiation, because I think more than any other league, the NFL, with all the amount of money and the incredible amount of money that they'll have 10 years from now, this is a critical CBA. I think even more than the other sports, and the players need to be careful what they do.
Absolutely, especially considering the NFLPA is considered one of the weaker unions, and it seems like they are most rife for being taken advantage of, because the dichotomy between the superstars and the rank and file is so divergent, and you've got that 3.5 year career. There are just so many factors that go into it that, you know, I suppose I learned today that you've got to be an expert analyst, whether it's with the numbers or with the game action, to make it by in the world of pro football today.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's going to do it for this week's episode of The Cheap Seats, brought to you by Public House Media. Make sure that you follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and subscribe on just about any of your podcast platforms of choice. For John Lauder, I'm Josh Powers, and we will see you in the future.